Last week, Alan did a devotional on Barabbas, and I want to pick up in that same passage this morning. Alan called me in Thailand, and he says, I'm just sick as can be. How about if I do a devotion and we do testimonies? And it sounded like you guys had a great worship last Sunday with all the testimonies. And so I want to pick up just a few thoughts on Barabbas this morning, and then... Continue on through this passage. But I want us to look at Matthew 27 and begin once again at verse 11. So if you have your Bibles and want to turn there, that's what we're looking at here today, okay? Beginning in verse 11, it says, Meanwhile, Jesus stood before the governor, and the governor asked him, Are you the king of the Jews? Yes, it is as you say, Jesus replied. When he was accused by the chief priests and the elders, he gave no answer. Then Pilate asked him, Don't you hear the testimony they are bringing against you? But Jesus made no reply, not even to a single charge, to the great amazement of the governor. Now it was the governor's custom at the feast to release a prisoner chosen by the crowd. At that time, they had a notorious prisoner called Barabbas. So when the crowd had gathered, Pilate asked them, Which one do you want me to release to you, Barabbas or Jesus, who is called Christ? For he knew it was out of envy that they had handed Jesus over to him. While Pilate was sitting on the judge's seat, his wife sent him this message, Don't have anything to do with that innocent man, for I have suffered a great deal today in a dream because of him. But the chief priests and the elders persuaded the crowd to ask for Barabbas and to have Jesus executed. Which of the two do you want me to release to you? Asked the governor. Barabbas, they answered. What shall I do then with Jesus, who is called the Christ? Pilate asked. They all answered, Crucify him. Why? What crime has he committed? Asked Pilate. But they shouted all the louder, Crucify him. When Pilate saw that he was getting nowhere, but that instead an uproar was starting, he took water and washed his hands in front of the crowd. I am innocent of this man's blood, he said. It is your responsibility. All the people answered, Let his blood be on us and on our children. Then he released Barabbas to them, but he had Jesus flogged and handed him over to be crucified. Then the governor's soldiers took Jesus into the praetorium and gathered the whole company of soldiers around him. They stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him, and then twisted together a crown of thorns and set it on his head. They put a staff in his right hand and knelt in front of him and mocked him. Hail, King of the Jews, they said. They spit on him and took the staff and struck him on the head again and again. After they had mocked him, they took off the robe and put his own clothes on him. Then they led him away to crucify him. And may God add his blessing to the reading of his holy word. This week, I was reading an article about moral rage. And it was a study that was done by some psychologists. And one of the things they discovered about moral rage is that moral rage is a tool that we use boy, that's a terrible picture up there, okay? The moral rage is a tool that we use to justify ourselves, that somehow when we get morally indignant and we fuss and fume and storm, we're justifying our own guilt. And in many cases, the moral rage is kind of a cover for the fact that we feel guilty. We think that by getting angry at others for their behavior, we can somehow excuse our own behavior. And mistakenly, the study said we believe that getting angry releases us from any responsibility for guilt. So anger can be this kind of tool that we fool ourselves with. It's true that we have all kinds of psychological self-deceptions that we use to convince ourselves that we aren't really as bad as those other people. In fact, we think we are pretty good people when it comes right down to it. And we think that our moral rage is justified. But the danger of all these manipulative mind games that we play is that we never really see our need for a savior. We're constantly trying to justify ourselves. And so we accept a false salvation of our own making that saves no one, including ourselves. But somehow maybe we feel a little better about it all if we can get good and angry at someone else. Now, here in Matthew 27, the gospel writer, Matthew, is telling us that to even come to the Savior, we have to first look upon our sin. And you see, that's the hardest thing for us to do, is to take a really honest look at our own sin. We don't like to look at it. We don't like to confront sin honestly and openly. And if we don't confront it, recognizing our own incapacity to deal with the sin that is looking back at us, we'll never discover the salvation that Christ offers. When Matthew tells us here in this passage of the man known as Barabbas, some of the manuscripts even call him Jesus Barabbas, which tells you that the name Jesus means salvation, and it means Barabbas had his own method of salvation. Barabbas' method was he was just going to tear everything up. We think that Barabbas would probably be considered a violent terrorist today. He would probably fall into the category of a man of righteous moral rage and thinking that that somehow justified him to do whatever he did. Barabbas likely saw his justification and salvation in the political power that he thought necessary to violently overthrow the infidels of pagan Rome. But Jesus the Messiah, not Jesus Barabbas, but Jesus the Messiah, was offering a different kind of salvation. He was offering a salvation from sin that only he could offer. And in a sense, Barabbas then is a picture of the man who has placed his faith in a salvation that doesn't really save. Barabbas probably didn't even realize that he needed such a savior. And there are many today who are dangerously unaware of their need for Christ, not realizing that Jesus is willing to take our sin and punishment that we might be set free. And that's the story of Barabbas. The good man died for the bad, that the bad might become the good. And I don't know if Barabbas immediately recognized the exchange that had taken place on his behalf, but it would seem at least likely that later on, as Barabbas looked back at these events, there may have been a little light that turned on as he saw what had happened. That there was this exchange that had occurred, that this man had been beaten with the stripes that he deserved. And he, the thief, the criminal, the terrorist, was set free. He may have wondered why an innocent man would die in the place of the guilty. "Which of the two do you want me to release to you?" asked the governor. "Barabbas," they answered. "What shall I do then with Jesus, who is called the Christ?" Pilate asked. And they all answered, "Crucify him." "Why? What crime has he committed?" asked Pilate. "He was innocent." And it says, "But they shouted all the louder, crucify him." Perhaps if Barabbas was Jewish, as many think he was, he may have been familiar with the words of the Old Testament prophet Isaiah, who wrote centuries before, actually seven centuries before, of a Messiah who would come and die for sinners. Now, maybe that dawned upon Barabbas at some point when he began to think about it and think back with perhaps some of the scriptures that he had learned as a child. But in that passage, Isaiah the prophet, or the Lord through his prophet, says, "But he, this Messiah who is coming, was pierced for our transgressions." There's the exchange. We sinned, but he was pierced. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on him. The punishment that we deserved was placed on him. And by his wounds, we are healed. Now, I don't know if Barabbas read those words, or if they dawned on him, or the Spirit of God brought those words to his mind. But the fact is, he may have recognized that. In that very next verse, the Lord says, "We all like sheep have gone astray. Each of us has turned to our own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all." And so the very next thing that it says about this Messiah is that all of us are sinners in need of a Savior. Barabbas was a living example of the truth of these prophetic words. But we don't know for sure that he ever came to faith in this true Savior of sinful man. But I'd like to believe that at some point he came to that realization, and that Matthew knew this once sinful man as a saint who now worshiped with other Christians as a living testimony to the power of the gospel. I can imagine Barabbas sitting in a congregation where people looked at him and said, "This is the man who stood beside Jesus. He was the terrorist. He was the criminal. He was the one who had murdered and slaughtered innocent people, and yet the innocent died for him." And Barabbas maybe sat in a congregation much like ours today, hopefully a redeemed man. You know, I don't know why Barabbas is mentioned. Maybe Barabbas was the source of some of this information that Matthew records. If so, Barabbas was the evidence of a gracious, undeserved blessing that God had poured upon every sinner through the sacrifice of his son who died in our place. Barnabas then, I think, came to the point of understanding that he was a debtor to God. And he had realized that he was a debtor because of the gracious salvation that he had received. Now, in the New Testament, we see that Paul, the Apostle Paul, also considered himself a debtor. You know, earlier, the worship team sang, you know, we owe it all to him. You see, I think Barabbas probably came to that point of recognizing, I owe everything to this Jesus. And that's the same discovery that the Apostle Paul came to, is I owe everything to this Jesus. And Paul considered himself a debtor. Now, let's go to Romans chapter 1. I didn't write these in the notes up there, but in Romans 1 and verses 14 and 15, Paul says, I am obligated both to Greeks and non-Greeks, both to the wise and the foolish. That is why I am so eager to preach the gospel also to you who are at Rome. And because Paul saw himself as a debtor, he said, I must preach this gospel because I have received this abundance of grace and mercy, and therefore I feel a duty to share the good news of the gospel with others. And when he says, I am obligated, the word that's used there in the original Greek is the idea of owing a debt. That I owe a debt to Jesus Christ. And Paul said, I'll travel the world because of all that Christ has forgiven me. And I wonder if Barabbas went through something very similar in his own realization. Later on in Romans, Paul speaks of his duty to share the gospel throughout the world. that he was called with a sense of duty to reach the world around him. Chapter 15 and verse 16, there Paul writes these words. He says, he speaks of the duty of proclaiming the gospel of God, so that the Gentiles might become an offering acceptable to God, sanctified by the Holy Spirit. Now, that's the mission that all of us are entrusted to today. It's the mission that Stephen just talked about. But we have a debt to send the message of the gospel forward to a world in need of that gospel, a world that is lost without that gospel, a world that has a multitude of false and imitation and powerless systems of salvation that will never bring them life. And we're the only ones with that message. And as Barabbas may have discovered that he was a debtor, as Paul discovered that he was a debtor, so every one of us here are debtors to Jesus Christ for all that he has done for us. We have become debtors. Later on in 1 Timothy 1 and 15 and 16, there Paul talks about, you know, of all that Christ had done in his life. And there he says, here is a trustworthy saying that deserves full acceptance. And Paul is writing this near the end of his life. And he says, Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the worst. And Paul, too, was a murderer like Barabbas. And he goes on and he says, but for that very reason I was shown mercy, so that in me, the worst of sinners, Christ Jesus might display his unlimited patience as an example for those who would believe on him and receive eternal life. Now, the modern church needs to have that sense of burden, of duty, of a debt that we owe. Because sometimes we feel like we are the privileged people, and we don't have to do anything. We're saved by grace, we live by grace, and so let me sit by grace. Paul didn't sit, he served. He didn't sit in one place. He traveled the ancient world to spread the news of the gospel. And at times we fail to cross the street to spread the gospel. We have to catch that burden of a sense that we are debtors. And we are under obligation to be serious about the mission that Christ has entrusted to us. Now, as he did for Paul, Jesus took the punishment that Barabbas deserved. And this hardened criminal was set free. In verse 20, it says, but the chief priests and the elders persuaded the crowd to ask for Barabbas and to have Jesus executed. That was the exchange. If Barabbas came to Christ, as I think likely, then Jesus took his sin and turned Barabbas into a saint. Jesus took the sin of Barabbas upon himself in order to transform the life of Barabbas, that he might become the saint that God intended him to be. Jesus took his death and he gave Barabbas a new life. That is an exchange that takes place in the life of every person who receives Jesus Christ as Savior. It is a salvation by grace that is paid for by God and offered freely to man. In 2 Corinthians 5:21, it says, God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. Jesus took our sin so that we would become righteous. That's the purpose of our salvation. It's not just to get us into heaven. It's to make us righteous and holy and godly people. A people who seek the holiness that only God can give to us through the sacrifice of Christ. And at times we go through our lives, you know, ignoring the call to sanctification. Now, if you look at 1 Thessalonians 4 and 1 through 3, you know, we see this aspect of the call to sanctification, to holiness. Paul, Silas, and Timothy to the church of the Thessalonians in God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. And he goes on in that passage and he says, if we can flip that over just a little further, I'm going to have to find it here. Okay, just a minute here. First Thessalonians 4. It says, the Spirit... No. Okay, I'm having trouble all over the place here. Let me get to 1 Thessalonians and I bet I will start to make sense, okay? 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 and verses 1 through 3. He says, finally, you know, I am still totally lost. That passage is not the passage that I... Okay, it's verse 3. I'm going to go right to verse 3. It says, it is God's will that you should be sanctified. It's a very simple command in 1 Thessalonians 4, 3. Ignore everything else. Ignore that man behind the curtain over there, okay? So, it's up there now. Okay, well, that's why I'm going to ignore it right now, okay? That's fine. So, but he makes it very plain. He says, it is God's will that you should be sanctified. Now, Paul makes it pretty plain. It means we have to deal with our sin. Christ died in order that we might become righteous. That we might do away with our bad attitudes, our stinking attitudes, with our sinful habits, with our lust, with our greed, with our gossiping. It says, put it aside. At different points, Paul says, you know, let not this sin even be evident among you as the people of God. Later on, Paul talks about how to live within the household of God. And he says, there's a way that we are to do it. There's a way that we are to behave. And so not only is there our personal life that is sanctified by the sacrifice of Christ, but it means our life together as the people of God is to reflect the fact that we are a redeemed, sanctified people walking in holiness. And that is to be evident to the world around us. Now, we can imagine this same Barabbas living in fellowship with other Christians as a man forgiven for his deeds. Many of his brothers and sisters in Christ were probably aware that, as I said earlier, that this man had once been a violent, murdering terrorist who now was probably a gentle Christian man in their midst, walking in obedience to the Christ who had saved him and living in gratitude for the miracle of his salvation and the realization that Christ had given his life that he might possess real life. And many of those Christians probably could not imagine that this man was ever an evil terrorist. But that is the power of the gospel. That is the power of the salvation that Christ offers to us. Barabbas did nothing to accomplish his salvation or deserve it, and neither can we. This passage tells us that Pilate released Barabbas in verse 26. But in reality, it was Jesus who released Barabbas. It was Jesus who took the flogging and the humiliation that Barabbas deserved. As the guilty Barabbas was set free, Roman soldiers took the innocent man to be stripped and mocked, spit upon, and beaten. And that is what would have happened to Barabbas. But Jesus took that for that man, an evil man. And he's taken it for us as well. Every stripe that he took upon his body, every laceration that cut to his bones was done for us. And he probably had your face on his mind as he died because he loves us. And there's never been a more incredible proof of the love of God for his people or the power of his redemption as the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. And it was Jesus then who really released Barabbas. Tiring of their abusive entertainment, at least for the moment, Jesus was then led away like a common criminal on his way to the execution that the other man deserved. And it says, they led him away to an execution, an innocent man dying for the guilty. In all of this, we see the incredible exchange of our sin and guilt and punishment placed upon our Savior. You know, maybe you've had those Christmas events where everybody gathers together and you've done a gift exchange at Christmas. You know, and they say, well, here's the limit. Everybody do a $5 limit on your gift. And you obey the $5 limit. You know, And in your gift exchange, you give them a $5 rubber band gun or something like that, you know, that is plastic. And they give you, you know, some KitchenAid thing, okay, that you know, is a few hundred dollars. And you go, oh, wow, this is embarrassing, okay? Well, when you see, in this exchange, Jesus took all of our sin. He took it all, and we received life. Now, that's an incredible salvation that is offered to us, and it's amazing grace that is offered to undeserving sinners. Barabbas is a reminder to all of us of the grace we have received and the gratitude and praise that our Savior deserves for his miracle of salvation offered freely to sinners like us. Now, in Isaiah 53, if we can pull that up again, in verses 7 through 9, we see there, it says, he was oppressed and afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth, exactly as we recorded in the Gospel of Matthew. He was led like a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before his shearers is silent, so he did not open his mouth. And Jesus then voluntarily took our judgment upon himself. By oppression and judgment, he was taken away. Yet who of his generation protested? For he was cut off from the land of the living. For the transgression of my people, he was punished. Jesus took all of the punishment and death that we deserved. And like Barabbas, we were set free from the penalty of sin. In this passage in Isaiah, we read, he was oppressed and afflicted. He was led like a lamb to the slaughter. He was taken away. He was cut off from the land of the living. He was assigned a grave with the wicked. That means our salvation is all of Jesus and nothing of us. He is the perfectly innocent man who took my place. Isaiah writes, he had done no violence. And yet we see that Jesus died here for a violent man. Isaiah also writes, nor was any deceit found in his mouth. And yet Jesus died for those who lied about him and brought false charges against him in the mockery of this trial. So here is the simple realization that every man must come to. We need the grace that only Jesus can offer. There is only one Savior who died in the place of sinners. There is only one salvation that can deal with the ugliness of our sin. There is only one salvation that transforms violent men into peaceful men, lustful men into pure men, and lying men into honest men. Jesus gave his life for Barabbas, and he has given his life for us if we will recognize our sin and receive the grace that we can never deserve. He took my place, he took your place. But unless we agree in faith and covenant with him, we will continue in our sin, and we will die for our own sin when he has done everything to deliver us from that sin and its eternal penalty. Jesus has done everything. The covenant is completed. The author of Hebrews asks this simple question: how shall we escape if we ignore such a great salvation? Jesus took the judgment that Barabbas deserved. He took the stripes and beating that would have fallen upon Barabbas. And he took the death reserved for Barabbas, and probably hung upon the cross intended for this violent man. And when you look at those three crosses, that central cross where Jesus died was probably reserved for Barabbas. And Jesus died upon that cross that was meant for the thief and the terrorist and the murderer, because he took his place upon that cross. That middle cross is where each of us deserve to be, except for the fact that this Jesus, this Son of God and Son of Man, died in our place so that we might know a new life and a new hope only found in him. Let's bow together in prayer. Father, we thank you that Lord, you took our place. You died upon that cross that we deserved in order that we might know life. And Lord, you have called us to be a people of gratitude and grace, that the same grace that we have received would flow through us as a people, that we would be merciful as you have been merciful, that we will be gracious as you have been gracious, that we will be loving as you have first loved us, that you will recreate in us the holiness that you first possessed. And Lord, you are in the process of redeeming not just individuals, but a people. And Lord, let us be yielded and submissive to the holiness that you want to recreate within your people and within the household of God. Lord, we pray now that as we partake of the bread and of the cup together, that you would remind us of the great price that you paid for us, your people. Lord, the grain was crushed in order that there might be bread. The grapes were crushed in order that the wine would be produced. And you, Lord, were crushed for our sins in order that we might have life. Lord, bless us now as we partake of this simple meal together of the bread and the cup. And Lord, we give you thanks and praise in Jesus' name. Amen. For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Come up here for just a second here, okay? Stephen shared just a little bit with us today. He shared about 45 minutes in Sunday school, but He's going to be sharing some pictures of Ethiopia and answering more of our questions tonight, and a very knowledgeable guy here. We've got him here, so if you can make it back at 6 o'clock, we encourage you to come as we talk about the mission of Christ. You know, it's important that we are effectively fulfilling the mission that he's entrusted to us. And Stephen is a valuable asset in helping us understand some ways that we can do that as a church family. So I encourage you to come tonight at 6 o'clock, and I'm going to put Stephen on the spot and let him do our closing prayer. Okay. Would you do that for us?
Let's pray together. Lord God, we give you thanks and praise that we can worship as your people, knowing that you have purchased us by the blood of your Son. We thank you, Lord Jesus, that you took the punishment that we deserved on yourself, and you gave us your hope and your life. We pray that we would walk by the power of your Spirit in this week to come, that you would strengthen us to do the work that you've given us to do in our work, in our community, and we pray that we would bear the truth of you wherever we go, and we pray that you would strengthen us to do this because of Jesus, in whose name we pray. Amen.
Amen.